Hello, hello, everybody. It is 7:39 a.m. Central Time on the 11th of February, 2019. It is Monday here in the USA, and I hope you're doing well. We are here to talk about seismic events. If you don't know where you're at, you're on the Earthquake 3D live stream. And we use the USGS with the EMSC, European Agency, to plot our earthquakes across the globe. And we look at roughly 48 hours worth of activity to give us a good picture of what's happening around the planet. And we need to start with an update. Over here in the West Pacific, we have new deep earthquakes, which have hammered off on the underside of the plate over the past couple days. And we started over here a day and a half ago, right on our letter D. Letter D stands for deep earthquakes, and the deep earthquakes are raised high off the globe for easy identification so you can see where they are. And we have one set here, two different deep quakes, and then we get over to here and we have another extremely deep earthquake right on our other letter D. This is, again, stands for deep earthquakes. We only have a few letter Ds placed across the planet, and these are spots where we watch for new deep earthquakes to strike. And we weren't let down. Now, the depth on these, what's going on? Well, the depth is down below the plates, down at 561 kilometers at this earthquake, and this one at 573 km. So we're talking about like 350 something miles down below in the asthenosphere. Now, the asthenosphere is just a complex word to describe the magma down below the plate. Now, what I think is going on where these deep earthquakes are happening, I believe a concentric standing wave is forming. Now, this is a wave of translation, which I'll explain in a second. But first, it forms a singularity that hammers into the underside of the plate when all the waves focus in on one point. Watch it in slow motion in this circular wave pool here, and you'll see it. It forms in on itself, and it compresses down into the fluid, but fluid's not very compressible, and it then hammers up into the underside of the plate in a single spike. Well, then something else, I think, happens. After that, a standing wave begins to form, but the standing wave spreads out from this hammer point here. It then spreads out through the plate, following weak points in the plate, throughout the plate. Now, we're not just talking about faults in the plate. We're talking about plate boundaries, because this is coming up from down below the plates in the magma itself. So it seeks out large deformations, large weak points in the plates. And of course, the largest weak points in the plates we have are our plate boundaries, separating spots between large plates. So between the Pacific and Australia, or between the Pacific and Asia, or between the Pacific and North America, Laurentia. And at those points where the plates intersect, that's where the force travels across. And then something else amazing happens. We get an equal distribution of force across the area where the wave spreads. And as the force travels across the distances, whether it's thousands of miles, and this is a wave tank, of course, very small, but imagine this happening over a vast distance and each one of these peaks being an earthquake or valley, we don't know which, but I think peak. At the peak point, I believe, is where the earthquakes are happening, and now it's shown with equal-sized earthquakes that pop off across the plate boundaries. As the equal-sized earthquakes pop off across the plate boundaries, as the wave moves and fills in each other's middle fulcrum point. Watch as the wave moves, see what happens here. So each wave fills into its previous depression. And now this is just a way a wave moves, but a standing wave, when all the waves combine, instead of interfering with each other, can actually form into a standing wave where the amplitude increases. That sounds complex, but just simply put, the power increases inside the wave and it gets taller or more powerful. Now in that wave tank, we're talking about Mother Nature's wave tank, which are the separation points between the plates thousands of miles across. And instead of a wave in a tank that's small, we're talking about a VLF or SLF wave, which is thousands of kilometers long, up to 10,000 kilometers long. And we'll see same-sized earthquakes dropped off across thousands of kilometers in the course of a day, in the course of 2 days. And that's what's happened since our deep earthquakes have now started to pop off, spreading out in both directions from our deep earthquakes. We have new activity that's slightly larger. So we have 5.1 on one side, and on the other side, so far, not slightly larger. So slightly larger, not slightly larger. Which way is the energy going? If we have a slight, like a scale leaning on one side, if it's leaning this way and we're getting more energy on this side than is released on this side, this means that force is going to travel out and across, or energy or the power. And then over to the west, it will compensate, just like a scale going in one direction and then bouncing back in the other. Well, the middle point here will come under pressure. Now, this gets me into the second portion on this, which is the other portion of the standing waves. Take a look at this. Nonlinear wave experiments from UCLA. And we're going to go in and look at a wave of translation. Now, watch this. As the disturbance is maintained, a standing wave happens in a single spot, isolated by a wave. Now look what happens as it spreads out. Now they can, of course, dampen that. That's something else that's, this is a whole nother topic here, the dampening of earthquakes. But I'd like to draw your attention to the Bolt experiment here that UCLA does. And as it begins to move, what you'll find out is that there's an equal distribution of force across the mass that has these bolts on the underside represent a motion on the underside, I believe, of the plate or in the magma. Now, something else amazing happens that they show in this series of experiments. There's a middle point here. Do you see this? Where it becomes still and the spots are moving on both sides. And that middle point, that fulcrum point, is sorted out naturally by Mother Nature. Sorted out naturally, middle points. Well, this is happening over a vast distance, which this means, this point here at Solomon Islands, west of Vanuatu, east of Papua New Guinea, right in here we have a middle point that's under stress. And this spot has already moved, which means this spot next to it should move to the west. I hope you understand what I'm talking about. Going to the west from there, we have an equal distribution of fours, and they're all the same size, 4.1, 4.0, 4.1, and then yesterday's 4.6 and 4.7. Again, two of the same size quakes from yesterday, marked in pink, from yesterday, 4.6, 4.7, and these, 4.0, 4.1. But it's an equal distribution of force since yesterday, just like what I showed you in the wave tank, where each wave peak was traveling across the tank. Well, imagine this being 3 points of three different waves across 1,500, 2,000 miles. Again, look at that distance and compare it to the United States. So we're talking about almost the distance of the United States across Sumatra all the way over to East Timor, and we have equal distribution of force. Now this deep 4.6 here and yesterday's 4.6 here, I think, speak for themselves. Again, they're the same size events. Going up to the north, it's gone hush-hush. It's gone quiet up across Philippines, Taiwan, South Japan, North Japan, Kuril Islands, Kamchatka, Aleutian Island chain, all quiet. Nothing in the course of a day. Well, we go back a day and you'll see we did spread. And not only was there a spread, but it was a spread of fives yesterday. So yesterday it was 5.0, 5.2, 5.1, 5.2, 5.3, all the way across the plate. We talked about that yesterday. And there was an earthquake right up in here as well, which I don't think that they reported. Well, we can get into that in just a little bit. But quiet, radio silence across a whole region, again, going from Philippines all the way up to Alaska. Let's go check the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center, because I know Sakurajima here, seen on screen, has been going nonstop. It's been blasting off over and over again. Let's see what's on the list now. Reventador in Ecuador a few times, Shivalush up in Russia a few times, 15,000 foot, or at least a extended warning. Shivalush, Sabancaya, Shivalush, Fuego over in Guatemala, Planchon Petoroa in Chile, Argentina's border region. Anybody else that we need to see? This goes into yesterday, but I want to take a look. Just Etna. And Etna doesn't normally make the Volcanic Ash Advisory Center list, only when there's explosive blasts. Normally there's just lava flows and small explosions at the volcano. All right, well, that's a low list. It really is. That's a low list. So we go from major eruptive activity, 50,000 foot high blasts over and over again. Hold on one second. Okay, hold on. I just want to make sure that earthquake, when did this strike? 8:16. Okay, all right. Just wanted to make sure. So the number of eruptions, that have happened here have dropped off after the 50,000-foot eye blasts. But with new deep earthquakes, it's pretty much a given that we can expect new eruptive activity to increase. I don't forecast eruptions, but when I see something like this, again, new deep earthquakes on two sides of an area 5,000 miles across or more, that means down below the plate, there's something going on that's going to be coming up through the plate. And as it comes up through the plate, we then see the earthquakes that spread out from these deep events. Let's go over into China and into Russia. So in China and Russia, what's going on? Well, you don't see any earthquakes, do you? Let's go back a day. Well, they have a 5.2. Wait, that's not in China. That's down here at the border of India and Myanmar, right at the bend of our arrow. Again, that happened yesterday, and I'm not shocked to see that. We see activity like this spread out across over the course of days. Here's the last 6 days. Let's look at the fives and greater over the last 6 days. So coming out of the West Pacific, big cluster of earthquakes. Let me turn on the rings, maybe. Maybe that'll help a little bit. Big cluster of earthquakes here, going across, then equidistantly spaced. Once we get over to here, we spread across the Caspian Sea and into South Europe. But look, it's all the same size. If we take the 5.3 plus the 5.1, guess what it equals? It equals 5.4. What did we start with to begin with? We started with a 5.3 to 5.4. Then a 5.3 to 5.4 spread out across the region. It split into two quakes, and then it recombined. So it's not that this 5.3 to 5.4 causes these two, which then causes this. It's that all four sets of quakes are caused by an inundating force that goes across the whole region and saturates the whole region, then popping off equal distance spaced same size quakes across that region. And here, where there's two plate boundaries, North Iran, South Iran, basically, it equally distributed itself across the entire area. And on one, it preferred to the south. Why would it prefer to the south? That's where the major plate boundary is between Saudi Arabia and Iran. The, I would call it a tertiary or a ancillary or a side plate boundary up here to the north. Okay. Going across Europe, let's take a look and see what's happened. For my people who live in Iran, and I do have a viewership in Iran, this is why you need to pay attention to what's coming out of China and why they're not reporting earthquakes out of China and Russia. Well, that gets into a whole political discussion that I do not want to get into, other than to tell you they aren't reporting, or the Western agencies, Europeans, Geofon Potsdam, EMSC, USGS, colleges, and all that sort of stuff, are not reporting earthquakes out of China and Russia, unless it makes it to news of some kind out of the region. It's crazy. And it's been, well, too long now. Do you believe whole continents go quiet for weeks? Is Earth stopping? Would you believe tides stopped across half the planet for a couple weeks? Yeah, tides just stopped. Hey, how about the weather? Weather? There is no weather. What are you talking about? There's no hot, there's no cold, there's no cloud, there's no sky. It just disappeared for a couple weeks. Over the whole region, no weather here, not a cloud, but no sun or darkness. It's just nothing. Do you believe that? Because if you do, I got a bridge for sale in Brooklyn. Let's go over into Europe. Let's start out of Turkey. Now, going across Turkey, this is right where we pick up a line of twos that goes down and prefers down towards Lebanon. And then we go up to the west by northwest. We get up next to Turkey again, right at the border with Greece and Crete. But you'll notice we're playing around with the same sized earthquakes, all the same size. So 3.5, 3.2, 3.0, 3.4. If you take this 3.4 plus this 3.0, it equals 3.5. So total amount of energy that was put into the system, 3.5. Total amount of energy that transfers across the system, 3.5. We get over here to the Adriatic Sea, and we have a 3.3. And we jump up to the west by northwest, and we have another 3, which was downgraded to a 2.9, and another 2.9 that was downgraded to a 2.7, up in the volcanic fields of Germany. Germany! This goes up next to my people, up here next to the Dutch border in Holland. Let's go get the coordinates. Go see what's up there. Inquiring minds want to know. So do I, so let's go find out. All right, where are we? Smack dab in the middle of the East Eiffel volcanic field. Activity at the East Eiffel volcanic field began about 0.65 to 0.45 million years ago. Their time frame, guys, with the formation of scoria cones. Scoria! And here we are. Lechner Sea is on the edge of the volcanic field, and you get the picture of how big it is. Do you think it's coincidence? Is that the only spot that's hit in Germany with an earthquake today? Near 3.0. Why does it matter if it's a near 3? Well, if you take this 3.3 plus this near 3 and this near 3, guess what it equals? It equals the total amount of energy put in to begin with, the other 3.5. So we trace it back, and total amount of energy put in here equals total amount of energy spread out across the whole plate. Now look where the other earthquake struck, the 2.9. Struck down at the Pyrenees at the border of France and Spain. This is something we expect. We expect the force to come up out of the Adriatic, go up and across, transfer across the plate, part of it to go down across to Gibraltar, the other part, if the push is big enough, to go up and across Germany, next to my people, and then go out here all the way towards Iceland and the North Mid-Atlantic Ridge. That's what's happening right now. Same with what's going on back behind here at the Greece-Bulgaria border, 3.0. Force travels across the plate. Simply put, as we go back across the Pacific, we jump over into Central and South America. Central America, I think, is where we'll start right here. 5.3 coming in at the border of El Salvador and Nicaragua. Now, I'd like to take everybody back a week. When the volcano came alive here in Nicaragua, what was it, San Cristobal? San Cristobal volcano comes alive here. Now, all of a sudden, we get mid-range 5s, or 5.3, 5.4, breaking out right at the border of Nicaragua. I don't think that's a coincidence. Look, you get a big volcanic blast, series of them, you haven't seen it on the list in a long time, and then within a few days, mid-range 5 hits your country. Now, you go up to the north, and we have a cluster of 4s in Mexico. Popocatépetl was erupting. Is it on the list again? I forgot. Hold on. Let's go take a look one more time. Is Popocatépetl on the list for today? No, and was it yesterday? Nope. All right, not on the list today or yesterday. Popocatépetl in central Mexico stopped erupting. Fuego is on the list. That's in Guatemala right here. As we go further down to the south, Reventador is erupting here in Ecuador. Sabancaya is erupting here in Peru, regular occurrence for both volcanoes. And then down to the south, the two new additions, which is Planchon, Petoroa, and Nevados de Chilean. Well, Nevados de Chilean technically is not going today. It was again yesterday, a day and a half ago. And Planchon, Petoroa is going over and over and over and over again. And that is a big change because Planchon, Petoroa was not on the list at all for an extremely long time. And the last time we really saw any major eruptive activity at Planchon, Petoroa was 1 month before the big earthquake back in 2011. 1 month before the Japan megaquake. Planchon, Petoroa came alive back in 2011. Well, here we are now in 2019. Let's talk about Eastern Central America going over into the Caribbean. You'll notice no earthquakes now, but a few days ago we did have a progression of activity go across Colombia. Let's go see if it's still on the... Yeah, here it is. There we go. You can see it. Let's get all the smaller earthquakes out of there. CR 4.4 here, marked in red. You see where it is, though. It's on our little red arrow. Well, we go right up here, and look who got hit yesterday. Venezuela, Southeast Caribbean, fulfilling my little forecast, the only forecast I issued for the week. So I told everybody I didn't issue a forecast. Somebody came back and said, yes, you did. You issue forecast. What are you talking about? They said, you said to watch in Venezuela. I'm like, oh, God. You can imagine my sarcasm back, right? I'm like, shut up. All right, here we go. Over to the east. So, a 4.7. There's nothing over to the east yet. I would expect coming out of Venezuela to go over to the east and see a new earthquake near 5 break out. The combined total of everything coming out of the Caribbean right now. And if you take the 4.7 plus all these 3s, take 10 threes, it equals about one 4.0 earthquake. So we're flirting around with right on the edge of 5.0 activity. I mean, 4.8, 4.9's worth of energy all the way across the Eastern Caribbean. From Dominican Republic across Puerto Rico, bending down and around and over to Venezuela. In this curved shape, this is a 20,000-foot drop-off. And this curved shape is actually the plate flowing around South America. You can see it much better on aerial photography. and satellite Google Earth view. Let me turn off all of our borders and labels here and all of our volcanoes. So up here, this is where our earthquake basically just hit, right in here on the eastern perimeter of Venezuela. But you see this. This is a bulge that goes down. No, well, actually, it's a, think of a cliff flowing over. Think of a mudslide. That would be another good way to look at this. Like a giant flow of mud going across over here to the east. And there's a 20,000-foot drop-off almost. 23,000-foot here and 19 to 20,000-foot here. And then it comes up in a bulge. All right, this is my contention now, that this is the Pacific plate flowing over and across, reaching over into the Atlantic. Now, before you scoff, South Sandwich Islands, all the way down here south of South America. Another 20,000-foot drop-off, 15, 20,000-foot. And look at our islands here, and look at our volcanoes. So we have the same shape, the same almost number of volcanoes, in the same distribution as all the way up here. And we have the same drop-off. Now, I'm going to do something that nobody does, which is turn the Earth on its side. We're going to look at it this way. And when you look at it this way, I think you'll be able to see that not only is it flowing down across and through these channels, the plate is flowing like a fluid over a long period of time. And this is a huge drop-off, and this is the flow over from this plate to this plate. And it's on both sides. Maybe I should back it out just a little more. It's on both sides flowing around like a wax over a long period of time. But what's caused that? Well, there's been force coming across for a long period of time, apparently. And it's following these fracture zones, which point like giant roads, which you can see maybe a little bit better on here on the NOAA fault zone map, like a giant set of roads pointing from where our deep earthquakes are, following the undersea mount chain and fracture zones, pointing right towards the spot that's flowing over into the Atlantic. That's what's up. I hate to break it to anybody who is in denial about that. It's not just my contention. It's something that's physically shaped that way. And we have to explain that shape. It's not just chance or coincidence. Let's get into South America. Let me get a sip of my coffee. Hold on. And sorry for bumping this dang microphone again. Okay. South America, other than that, our earthquakes are small compared to where we were a day and a half ago. 2 days ago, we were at fives. Now we've dropped off to fours. Those fours dropped off to threes. But new deep earthquakes here. New deep earthquakes here hammering up on the underside of the plate. Remember, deep earthquakes hammering up on the underside of the plate. Let me show it to you one more time. Sorry, guys. I should have it queued up, but whatever. There we go. So hammering up here on the underside of the plate, out of the magma, and then spreading out. But when it spreads out, it goes through the plate. It's coming up from the underside, goes through the plate, finds the cracks in the plate, not faults, the actual fracture zones and plate boundaries. Now you see the fracture zones. They're east-west facing, equal distantly spaced all the way up the Pacific, and go all the way down here to Leviathan, which is just the symbol of the force coming up from down below. Once we get to the equator, they start to prefer to the southerly direction, but the equal distance spacing on them can still be seen. But you'll notice something, or I hope you'll notice something, and I've shown it so many times before, that these fracture zones, these east-west facing fracture zones, go over here to the west, and they meet up with this giant diagonal line of undersea mounts. These are all volcanoes undersea. And it goes down and makes a crescent shape and bends into South America. But we can follow it back, and it goes back up and meets with the Hawaiian Island chain, and then carries on up to Kamchatka up here. Again, the crescent shape of this, well, bisecting ridge going across the entire Pacific. The Hawaiian Island chain juts off it in a Y shape or a V shape, goes over to the east and kind of centers out there in the middle of the plate. But our equal distribution of cracks or fractures in the plate all pretty much stop. And I say pretty much because there's two of them that carry over into here. You see them. The two fracture zones that carry on beyond this line, this dividing line. But equal distribution of force across this whole region has caused these equal spaced fracture zones to form in the plate. It goes back to this ridge, which means there's upwelling pressure coming in on the underside of this portion of the plate, and then it flows across the plate and hits South America, which is justified. This idea that I'm proposing here is then further justified by the flowing around the plate of the force as it hits South America like a wall. This flowing force of power, or translation of energy across the, or a wave of translation going across, and it causes physical movement in the plate, maybe through a series of earthquakes or volcanic eruptions over a long period of time. But it would mean the plate is flowing. Instead of being a rigid thing that we all were taught that it is, it would be more flowing like a fluid, that the plates would flow like a fluid in some instances over a long period of time. And that's further given away by shapes in the plates that are bent and twisted and flowing like a river. Over here in Iran, for instance, and Afghanistan, the flow of the plate. But if there's a flow of the plate, that turns everything on its head, right? Okay, let's go. Now that I'm done turning all that on its head, let's get into the continental United States, Alaska, and Hawaii. So what's going on? A mahalo for all my Hawaiian viewers. Looky, looky, looky here. What have we been dealing with for the last several days? How about a series of earthquakes not at Kilauea? How about a series of twos and near threes striking all around Mauna Loa and up to the north, next to Mauna Kea and Hualalai? So I'm going to have to say a bunch of the same-sized earthquakes, 2.6, 2.7, striking at Hualalai, Mauna Loa, and Mauna Kea must mean something. It can't just be chance or coincidence that all the same-sized earthquakes strike at three volcanoes surrounding Kilauea. But there's only one possible explanation for all three volcanoes showing the same-sized earthquake. There's only one possible explanation. I mean, well, there's two. One, the one that I would lean towards, Occam's razor. Mother Nature. Force spread out across the whole big island, going to the weak points. Hualalai up here. Let me turn my volcanoes back on. Mauna Loa here, which is, this is the coordinates for the earthquake. Look where it's coming in. It's coming in up at the top caldera. And Mauna Kea up here. But it goes around Kilauea. Kilauea is the spot that collapsed. And Kilauea is the Middle East rift zone that's re-inflating. If you're from the Big Island, you know what I'm talking about. Or if you're a longtime viewer of mine, you know what you're, well, you know what I'm talking about. You know what you're talking about too, probably. Take a look at it, though. We're on Kilauea's flank, and this whole thing has collapsed. It's gone. It doesn't even look like this anymore. And now the other volcanoes are starting to move. That, what I'm getting at here is that this is reinflating, and these are starting to show activity spreading out across the entire big island. You shouldn't be shocked by that. What you should be shocked by is that the professionals would tell you that the volcano has stopped erupting and said it was all clear the day the tour season began, the last day of summer. The first day of fall, they announced that it's all good and opened the park back up and let everybody in. I mean, come on. Okay, so that's what's going on in Hawaii. Other than that, I don't have an update for you. They stopped doing science at the Hawaiian Volcano Observatory long about last year sometime. And let's go see what they got going on. I haven't been over there in weeks, so this should be pretty fun. Mauna Loa, green all normal, except for all those earthquakes hitting there, guys, right? Right, HBO? Hey, I love this one right here. Womp, womp, ba-dum. Play the Price is Right losing horn along with this. Kilauea volcano is not erupting. Bum, dum, ta-dum. You lose it, Plinko. And we go down here across the Pacific. I shouldn't say down here. We go across the Pacific over here over to the continental United States. And what you'll see is a line of fours coming out of Alaska, dead ending into Vancouver Island. And that line of fours goes from 4.4 down to 4.2 down to 4.1 and up here all the way to the north. We go up to the northern slopes of Alaska with our larger earthquake of 4.8. This all happened yesterday going into today. Now I do have something to report to you. A new 3.3 just shook up the southern portion of San Joaquin Valley. 13:07, about 1 hour ago, 59 minutes ago. But you can see these fours, right? And the equal distribution again, going out across going down into the United States. And that equal distribution of force, one more time, as seen in the standing wave tank, happens very quickly. It doesn't take much time for a wave to spread through something, especially if we're dealing with a fluid going into a solid or impacting into a solid. Now, without the waves interfering with each other, instead combining, then you get the standing wave, and the standing wave then drops off the earthquakes along the way. This is the force that's causing the earthquakes, I think. So again, it's not that this 4.4 then causes this 4.8, 4.2, 4.1 in a chain reaction like dominoes falling. It's more like a Newton's cradle, where the whole set gets moved and there's a distribution point to point to point to point to point. And then we could see, you could even combine in the wave of translation, which I showed you in the screw experiment there that was done by UCLA just a few minutes ago. And with those bolts moving and the middle bolt standing out as a silent point, a spot that's going to be absorbing energy or is not absorbing energy currently. But when the area shifts, that's when we see the drop-off of earthquakes go across the entire region all in the course of a day. Does that make sense? So this whole region, from the Alaskan Aleutian Island chain all the way down to Vancouver Island, was inundated with a force that was equal to 4.8, and it distributed itself, distribution, across the entire area. Now we go back a day. All we have to do is go back one day, and you'll see the previous push, where it came from to begin with. Where did Alaska get moved from? The energy was here, and it showed at 5.1, 5.0, 4.4, 4.6. Then it transfers, and we see 4.4, 4.1, 4.8, 4.2, 4.1. Then it's going to transfer again. And when it transfers again, it goes into the continental United States and is absorbed by the Juan de Fuca fracture zone, the lightning bolt-shaped fracture zone here off the West Coast. Then something amazing happened. The North American craton gets displaced from northwest to southeast, and earthquakes pop off along the edge of the North American craton. Now the craton interior is stable. The exterior, the purple portion that meets up with the edge of the stable craton, that's the portion that allows the energy to escape. And guess what we have done all the way across the edge of the craton? We've drilled the edge of the craton. So let's go take a quick look at this earthquake down here in the valley. This new 3.3 that just struck in San Joaquin Valley. I'm going to turn on our 0.0 and greater earthquake feed here in the U.S. This is just going to show us the last day's worth of small earthquakes, and going up to the 4.1, of course, from last night going into this morning. But what I'd like to draw your attention to is the earthquake that just hit in California. And there it is. 3.3. Coordinates of Huron, California. What is in Huron? Longtime viewers should know what's next to this. Extra credit points if you can name it out before I show it. Here we are. We're looking at beautiful California. And we're right here, and this is the famous San Andreas Fault. Now right next to here is Parkfield, California. I'm going to turn on my town name so you can get a better picture of what we're looking at here. Here's Colinga, and here's Parkfield. They call this the earthquake capital of the United States and the world. You can go into town and get souvenirs. It's pretty cool. But this whole thing is creeping. This is the San Andreas. Well, our earthquake is right here. So the earthquake capital of the United States right here, and our earthquake striking right there, they must be related, right? Well, there's something else here. Do you see all these little square pads laid out across here? Let me zoom in a little bit. Now, this is a solar farm right there. But next to the solar farm, all these. Do you know what these are? Have you ever seen something like this before? This is the shadow of a jack or a pump. And, of course, it's next to many other pumps. And this is not a storage yard for oil well pumps, guys. This is a large oil and gas pumping operation that goes on for miles. Every spot is a drill point that goes down a few hundred to a few thousand, maybe even more feet. Sometimes at angles, not just straight up and down, these go out in all angles. And our earthquake right on the edge of the pumping operation. So, what they've done, and I call this the West Coast Drill Point Capital. So next to the earthquake capital, they made a drill point capital. Do you think that's a coincidence? Do you? I mean, you're welcome to believe whatever you want, but I think, again, we would have to lean back towards only a fool would think that perforating the plate like that, thousands and thousands of times, drilling out by hundreds to thousands of feet per well, that is going to create a perforation, a weak point, next to the greatest fault zone that you know of on the entire plate. Wouldn't they be doing that to maybe prevent an earthquake on the San Andreas Fault by drawing over the energy to that perforation point like a break in concrete? Just a little point I'd like to raise. Now let's go up to the west by northwest. Actually, hold on. Before we go to the west by northwest, let's go over here to my neck of the woods. Here in the Midwest. Oh, wait. Dang it. I'll tell you what. That Craton diagram didn't turn off when I was trying to show you pumps out in California. It's the 100th time it's happened. Only California now. It's the weirdest thing. I'm going to go back and show you. Just because that dang thing was in the way, distracting you, take a look. These pumping operations on the edge of the Craton. Okay, now, I swear, it's the weirdest thing. That graphic stays on when I try to show pumping operations in California. Only California. Weird. Let's go out here to the Midwest, over to Ridgely, Tennessee. This goes on to the edge of the Craton in the Midwest. So now that you've seen that dang Craton diagram shoved into your face for a couple minutes, you should remember that it goes over to the Midwest. And it makes a bend going right through into southern Missouri. Now that bend in the edge of the Craton goes through the New Madrid seismic zone here. And Haiti and Caruthersville, Steele, Blytheville, all this right next to and south of the New Madrid seismic zone itself. And this is the town of New Madrid right here. And it is New Madrid, not New Madrid. But there's something else nearby. Would you believe that they've done a bunch of drilling and pumping up here, right on the north side, going between the Wabash Valley and the New Madrid seismic zone, just a few miles to the north? Now, it's more than 10 miles, but we got a large pumping operation here. Why? Why would you drill out all the way around here when you know it's the Wabash Valley seismic zone and the New Madrid seismic zone? Oil and gas? Really? I don't know. To me, that just stinks of them, the professionals, knowing that drill points are weak points, perforations, and drilling on purpose to create a weak point. Now, they'll use the oil and gas as an excuse to get in there, maybe, but I don't trust that they don't know at this point. How could you not know that drilling into something that's seismically tense could cause that tension to release at the spot, the weak point that you're creating? How could you not know that? Right? How could anyone not know that, especially professionals? So let's go and look into Oklahoma, where we're going to go into another spot that humans have drilled, just like the other one. So another one, just like the other one. And what are we looking at here? Let's zoom in and show you. Well, you see houses, right? That surely must be what's the cause of the earthquake, right? No. Right next to here are a series of frack wells where humans drill in. They drill up to a few miles in some instances, and they inject wastewater, which is really just chemical-laden water, to break apart the shale down by a few kilometers at some instances. And these pumping operations are massive. So they've drilled the heck out of this, and it releases the tension at the area when it comes across the plate. So if tension comes across the plate, or the power or the force that I'm talking about here, this force that's inundating the plate, the wave as it's traveling across the plate, if you put a weak point in the plate, or you drill into it, it's going to seek out that weak point. Same with the volcanoes on the West Coast. And then that gets me into a whole nother discussion about what's going on the West Coast as opposed to the Midwest. Are weak points in the Midwest on the edge of the Craton? Are weak points on the West Coast on the accretionary belt, going out to the coastal plain, are all at either volcanoes or drill points? We could go through all of these and find only a handful of actual fault zone earthquakes. So for instance, this one here, a 1.8, and the 1.6, and the 0.7. Okay, these three quakes here, fault zone, and down here, down southeast of LA, starting right about here at Big Bear, and going down to the east, southeast, down to here. These are fault zone. But this point here,
this point here, this point here, this point here, this point here, these all across Eastern California, every single one of them is either at a Mother Nature-made punch point or a human-made punch point. And when I say punch point, I either mean volcano, geothermal field, or a human point where humans have drilled in to get geothermal or oil. Now, there are some exceptions to the explosion points, which are nuclear test sites over here that are weak points that stand out as well. So the nuke test sites get hit, the drill points get hit, the volcanoes get hit. And I'll prove it to you if you need me to, but I think you could prove it to yourself by just looking up the earthquakes. If you're in doubt, you can just go pull the earthquakes going in Eastern California, and it's going to bring you next to a volcano at each spot. I'll show you, starting here up in Northern California, geysers. Another stack of earthquakes going up to near 3.0 at geysers. So what's at geysers? Well, pipeline. Pipelines that go up to these turbines. The turbines are spots where geothermal heat turns the turbine. The geothermal heat's coming next to Geyser Peak and Clear Lake Volcanic Field. That's where we start, and the number of earthquakes here is low, so our frequency is low, but our power is high. So frequency is the number of quakes, and the power is the magnitude. So we're looking at 2.9 near 3.0. Where did that come from? Why is it suddenly going up into the 3 range? We just had a 4.1 up here off the coast last night going into this morning. Now, up in Washington, we also have some activity that's taking place, but it's small at this point, at least small power-wise. And it's 2 events, so it's 2 small events. But let's take you into Amboy and show you what's in Washington. Look where we are. We're right inside the crater of Mount St. Helens. Now, this is a change. It's nothing to be alarmed about. It doesn't mean an eruption is going to happen here. We're on the edge of the flank of Mount St. Helens. A day ago, or 2 days ago, we were very far away, a few miles out, around the volcano. Now we're back on the inside center. Nothing to be alarmed about. The volcano is just slightly moving, slightly as forces coming in from the northwest. Again, remember, we just had a 4.1 up here off the coast. We get into the Seattle area. Let's go look this one up. I just want to find out about this one. Go see how close it takes us. Just curious. It's just a microquake where we're going, so don't worry. But this should take us next to Mount Rainier, I think. Okay, we're on the edge of Mount Rainier. You know what? It's far enough away, I'll say. It's not directly related, but we always look within 40 miles. Let's see if it's that far. Whoops. Come on now. I guess I need to click on it proper. There we are. 31 miles. I always look within 40 miles. It's on the edge of too far away. Now, what's the other thing that's here? The only other thing that's here. This ties in with the slow slip that happens up here to the northwest. Let's go open the Pacific Northwest Seismic Network and University of Washington real-time tremor map. Here we are. 48 hours. And in the last day, there's only been a handful of tremors. And in the last 2 days, there's again not been many. Up in Washington, just 1 out in the Strait of Juan de Fuca. 1 off the coast, out in the Cascadia subduction zone, the rest on land. The predominance being in Northern California, with a line of these little red dots going up to Portland. Now, these are not earthquakes, these are small vibrations as the plate shifts. So shifting in Northern California, no earthquakes in Northern California today. And another day, USGS not reporting any earthquakes out of Oregon. Coffee time. Let's get another sip of that coffee while you let that sink in. No earthquakes. Okay. Hey, let's go down into California and look up those other quakes that I said were at volcanoes to continue proving my case. So let's go over to the east. See this 2.1 and 1.6? Go grab the coordinates next to Silver Springs at a 6.6 kilometer depth. Silver Springs. Maybe the silver comes from some silver mining in the area. Who knows? Guarantee you these springs are not golden or silver when you look at them. We're right next to Soda Lakes. Soda Lakes gets its name from the effervescence in the lake that's here, but this apparently blasted out in the past. This is a Smithsonian-marked volcano, and lo and behold, we're right next to it. Now, down to the south, we have Churchill Butte, but I'm going to look to the large feature that's here that's marked by the Smithsonian, the only one around for miles. So that's where we start. Let's go down to the west by southwest. We can get the 2.9 or the 0.9. Let's get the 2.9 since it's coming in south of Lake Tahoe. Mark Leeville. We haven't had to look this up before, have we? It's at a negative 1.1 kilometer depth, which either means it's up inside of a mountain or it's slightly miscalculated on depth. I'll lean towards the up inside of a mountain or above sea level pretty far. Certainly are above sea level, but we do have a quarry here. You know, they could be doing some quarrying here, and it could be a misidentified earthquake. However, Kim Jong-un's nukes showed up as 5.0. So to get 3.0, that would be pretty significant size blasting going on at the location. I'm not saying that they're not, but didn't they just get something like 8 feet of snow out here or something in the Sierra Nevadas? I'm just curious. Maybe there's something going on up there avalanche-wise that took care of that spot. We'll have to wait to see, but again, 2.9 is huge. Going down to the east by southeast, 0.9 coming in next to Bridgeport. 21 kilometers away from Bridgeport, actually. So how could it be related to volcanism? Well, let me show you. Backing this out, do you see it? Well, maybe I need to show it to you a little bit closer. We're on the edge of two huge volcanic fields, one Mono Lake, the other Long Valley, and then to the north, there's even more, but I'm more concerned with the huge volcanic field right next to the earthquake itself. So Mono Lake, and we've talked about it many times in the past, the rising Pahoa Island out of the center of Mono Lake. Jumping down further down to the east by southeast, we go into Nevada. What is over in Nevada? Would you believe me, it's just like any of the other locations that I'm showing you? Save the one that could be the avalanche of some kind. Surface, again, look where we are. We just jump right across from up here to down here. That's all we've done. And what's here? Mount Hicks, Aurora Peak, and Aurora Bodie Crater, along with Mud Springs Volcanic Butte. And don't forget, if you're a longtime viewer, you already know about this. New viewers, this ring of laccoliths, which are bulges in the plate. Each one is a separate bulge point fed by a magma chamber for this down below. And some of them have ruptured in the past like this. Further over to these two earthquakes on both sides of that. Here, let me just pull the coordinates and show it to you. 12 kilometer depth, perfect match for this magma chamber that would be feeding this down below, probably about that depth. Once again, right on the side, right on the flank. And we go up to the east by northeast of that, right across that little valley. So we go right from here up to here. Layer, let me pull it so you can see it. Fisher Ridge. Whoops. This should take us to Fisher Ridge. Gabs. Gabs, Nevada. We're going to Gabs. All right. Will you guys gab about this? Take a look where the earthquake hit. It's right on the Fisher Ridge. We were to the north last week. Now we're right on it. So this confirms my suppositions last week that this was related to Fisher Ridge, that the movement that was happening right here was tied to the fissures that have torn through the plate in the past. There's a weak point here. No duh, right? So I just proved it to you. Every spot, except for the one that's at the surface, negative 1.1 kilometer depth, and I mean right on the surface, and they just had 8 feet of snow out here. So, last week or something. Let's go down to the south. Let's jump back over to this final 1.3, bringing us in at Meadow Creek, Dixon Lane, California. But this is the same spot. This whole area up in the mountains got, I think it was 8 feet. 8 feet or 10 feet of snow. I'm not saying this one. This is it down in the crust. What is the depth on this? 8.8 kilometers down in the crust. So it's not an avalanche, this. So what is it? This. This is a supervolcano. 240 cubic miles of melt down below the location. And, or 1,000 cubic kilometers or something. And Mammoth Mountain, Mono and Yoke craters going all the way around the outside edge of Long Valley Caldera. Now, in the middle of here, humans drilled into it to get steam to turn the turbines. And the pipeline spread out to the drill points and so forth, just like all the other geothermal locations. We're right on the edge of the supervolcano. That's where our earthquake is. Now, I mentioned nuclear test sites. Yes. Now, they're not doing nukes out there now. Again, it would be huge seismic signatures if they were doing that. These are microquakes in these fracture points. Humans created. So humans created fracture points in the crust from doing all of what I'm about to show you, all this. All of these are different craters from different underground nuke tests. And let me just get some of the info on U.S. Nuke Operation Cornice Green SS, May 15th, 1970, 40 kilotons. U.S. Nuke Operation Labis, February 5th, 1970, 25 kilotons. Now, one of these didn't get contained. It actually blew out, and they actually did some kind of, I don't know. I don't know why they have it marked as a volcano. It did some kind of ejecta of some kind that was not contained. Pretty interesting to see that. So our nuke test sites start there. We're at the north tip of the valley. You come down here to the east by southeast or the west by southwest. This just takes us down to the east by southeast, down to the south tip of the test zones where there's more underground test sites. U.S. Nuke Operation Mandel Horehound, August 27, 1969, less than 20 kilotons. And we keep going, and Doomtown is down here. This was the surface nuke test sites. So fractures in the plate over and over again. Weak points. Proof that Mother Nature seeks out weak points. That's what it is. It doesn't matter whether it's oil, gas, geothermal, nuke test site, or volcanic. Or fault zone. But Mother Nature is preferring these deep weak points as opposed to the shallow weak points that are like fault zones in the plate. As we go down to the west by southwest, this 1.8 should bring us in next to Volcano Butte. It says Searles Valley, California. This is basically taking us into Death Valley type locations. Extreme desert. Where are we? On the edge of Zinc Hill, and I said Volcano Butte, right? Here's Volcano Butte right here. And next to Volcano Butte is Volcano Peak with its fresh lava flows. But the earthquake, all the way up here next to Zinc Hill, this is on the other side of our geothermal pumping operation. Once again. So pipelines, drill points, geothermal turbines. Devil's Kitchen is the name of that, on the edge of Kozo Volcanic Field. Proving it to you over and over again, every one of these spots, Eastern California, save the one that could be a landslide at the surface, every one of these, at a weak point, Mother Nature created or humans created, including the one in the valley. Like I said, the only earthquakes that appear to be on faults are here, here, and here, and then in Southern California, down here on the San Jacinto, of course, we know that's fault zone related. But I want to look up this last earthquake before we get down there, and that's this 1.3 over at Kernville, California. 7.1 kilometer depth. Kernville. All right. Another mountain peak with trees, but there's something right next to here. Well, two things. One, over to the east, two, over to the west. Both are very interesting. Over to the east, we have the geothermal pumping operation and Volcano Peak that I just showed you. Down to the east by southeast, we have our odd fissure. And these are fissures. This is not a fault or a man-made wall. This travels on for miles through the undersides of these mountains even and carries on up to the west by northwest. And I've shown this to you in previous videos, so we don't need to. But look where it goes towards. I mean, it's heading right towards the earthquake. There are odd fissures. But I said there's something interesting over here, and there is. starting right about here, we have an excessive pumping operation. Now again, we're in the Valley of California, San Joaquin, south of Sacramento. Look at it. Look how many there are. All of these drill points. Now, it doesn't stop. It just keeps going. And we can go into the mountain ranges here and keep going up to the north. You'll find more and more of them. Imagery date as of 2018 on this right here. That's cool. It's good to see. And I think we putter out right about in here on the pumping ops. There may be some more. I think there are just a few. There are a few intermittently spaced a little bit further to the north. But we're close enough. Again, we are right next to it. Now, I would also like to point out California Hot Springs is here, and we go just up to the north, and we have this. Now, I don't want to get too much into this, but this right here, this ring of volcanoes, one of my viewers pointed this out to me right here. Again, we still to this day don't know what to make of that. But this ring of volcanoes, right on the backside of here, Camp Nelson. The big fires that broke out here, guys. Just a few months back. Going down to the west by southwest. We're north of LA, but this is right on the San Andreas. Castaic, California. And let's get our fault zones turned on. There we go. So now we're getting into fault zone. This big, thick red line is the plate boundary. It's called the San Andreas, but it also is called the Imperial Fault down to the south. It's really just the break in the plate. So they've given it a name, the San Andreas. And on the San Andreas, it branches off into the Elsinore and San Jacinto. This is the San Jacinto. This is the Elsinore. So San Jacinto, Elsinore. Elsinore goes up and meets up with where our earthquake is. As we go down across the LA Basin, let's go look this one up. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Let me get a sip of my coffee. Oh boy. Hold on.
Go look it up together, shall we?
You're traveling through another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. A journey into a wondrous land whose boundaries are that of imagination. Your next stop, the Twilight Zone.
All right. Let's go take a look and see what's here. What's here in the Twilight Zone? Oh. Uh-oh. Uh-oh. Come on, everybody. Say it along with me. Oopsie! Got a mistake earthquake next to these offshore drilling platforms. Must be just a coincidence. That's it. Ah, this big refinery here with all the processing equipment and stuff. Yeah, whatever that is. But I'm going to have to say it's right next to our offshore drilling platforms. The only ones. Eh, well, you know, got a mistake. Little mistake. Let's go over to the east by southeast. Go look at this stack of earthquakes. Oh, wait. Hold on. Let's open up the fault zone map first. See where this star is. This star represents where our swarm of earthquakes is here, this big stack. Now, I'm going to go pull this 1.3, and we're going to look where it is in relation. So this 1.3 down here on the thick red line and the star up here on this little thin series of red lines on the San Jacinto. So the star, what's at the star location? Why are the earthquakes stopping over here? It's the southernmost point over to the east on the San Andreas. Why is it stopping there? Niland, California. You may remember Niland was in the news a couple months ago, a month and a half, 2 months ago, when the mud pots at the volcano here started to shift in Southern California. Salton Buttes. Do you guys know about the volcano in Southern California east of San Diego called Salton Buttes? Elevated to active in 2012 when sulfur smells appeared across the region. They tried to blame it on dead fish and seaweed. They had to come back and admit it was sulfur dioxide and hydrogen sulfide even mixed in with it. Now, the mud pots here shifted a couple months ago, 60 feet in one day. The railroad had to get involved because apparently the mud pots shifted over next to the railroad and started to erode away at the base of the tracks. But this, Salton Buttes, on the side of Salton Buttes, look what humans are doing. Drill points. Drill points to get the steam. So they've done, again, another series of geothermal pumping operations at this location, just like all the others. So then that connects us back up to all of our earthquakes, this stack that's on the San Jacinto, and the stack that's on the San Jacinto, here, where the star is, this is the slow slip in Southern California. As identified by the professionals, not me, they said this is slow slipping. But what they, the professionals, have failed to notice is that when this picks up like this, we then see force transfer over into Texas and Oklahoma, usually, sometimes Southern Colorado, but usually it's West Texas, then into Oklahoma. We'll see a series of earthquakes about the same size. So we'll see, like for instance, here we're going up to 2.6, a bunch of twos, maybe add it all together, it equals about a 3. We should see something like a 3 pop off over here in West Texas, going up into Oklahoma pretty soon. Now, if that doesn't happen, if the force doesn't transfer out of Southern California and go over into Texas, which it should, and you see the faults here, marked on their fault zone map even, it should go from here to here. And if it doesn't, then tension builds on the deformed outside edge of the accretionary plane or the coastal plain accretionary belt, and we get an earthquake, large size, down in Southern California. But that's only when energy usually doesn't transfer over to Texas. So if we don't see an earthquake in Texas, then we watch Southern California for something about the same size as the force that was introduced to begin with. In this case, we're dealing with fours, force introduced. But the four, where the force is introduced, is far up to the northwest, which means part of this should break across and we should see an increase over at Yellowstone again. We should also see an increase at the panhandle of Oklahoma coming in from the northwest. So it's going to be a double hit. There's going to be something coming in from Southern California going over to Texas, and there's going to be a new push coming in from the northwest going down through Yellowstone coming into Oklahoma. So coming in from both directions, 4.1 energy to the north and 3.0 energy currently to the south, both heading over to the east in the next couple days. That is what's going on. So, do you have an earthquake plan? Do you know what to do when an earthquake strikes? You should take the time to develop an earthquake plan and at least think about it, what you would do if an earthquake hits. Where are you going to take shelter? I see video after video of people running around when an earthquake's striking, looking for a place to take shelter. And you should already think about that. You should just think about where you'll go, pick out a table or a desk, or if you don't feel that the table or desk is going to be sufficient enough to support falling things from the ceiling, you would need to then get outside. And if you're going to go outside, you better know your surroundings, because you could be running into a worse situation than just staying in place or taking shelter. Now, taking shelter inside of a building, it's not, if you, you know, your table or desk is not going to support a fully collapsed structure. So if you're not confident in the structure that you're in, particularly stone or brick, stone stack construction, if you're in that kind of construction, you should probably have an exit plan. And if you're going to go outside, or if you're going to stay inside, you should probably have an emergency kit that you can either grab after or before and have it easily accessible so you don't have to go dig through closed closets and doors that could be jammed and all that kind of stuff to try and get to it. So have an emergency kit, and that emergency kit can come in handy for everything from an earthquake to severe weather or evacuations for floods or fires, and you can just have your basic needs met for the first couple days in a backpack or bag that you can grab easily. And it's suggested for change of clothes, set of shoes, extra ID, insurance card, set of keys, flashlight, batteries. You get the drift. You can come up with better ideas than what I'm saying now. I'm just reminding you to do it. And I do this every time I do an update. I remind everybody. Because I know I'm always reaching some new person who's like, oh, yeah, Yeah, I'll do it. And then if you do it, you'll be so much better off. Even if you just think about what you're going to do, you'll be way better off than all the other people who don't give it a lick of thought. Okay, I'm going to save this, hopefully, as a video over on YouTube, and we will get it out to the world. It's just an update, letting you know what's going on around the planet. If you like what I do, you can come over and subscribe to my channel. I'd appreciate it. Still trying to grow it into something significant, I know. I don't know if it'll ever happen, but maybe we'll break 300,000 at some point. Everybody over on YouTube, thank you for your help. And everybody on Twitch, word up and much love. Let's say hi to everybody. Here we are. So we're all good, right? Everybody doing good, sharing the information, getting it out to the world. Thank you to everybody on Twitch for doing your part as well. If you want to support my operation, one final way to do it, you can get a dutchsinse item. Dutchsinse t-shirt, pressure transfer map. You can see the arrows and the X's. And you can see it says on the back, dutchsinse earthquake forecasting. You know, hey, what happened to that? What? Are you serious? Yeah. Maybe we'll get back to it at some point. Maybe I won't. Maybe I will. Maybe I won't. Maybe I will. Maybe I won't. Regardless of whether or not I get back to forecasting, I already showed the world how to do it. Put out directions and everything. How to forecast an earthquake. You know what happened to those directions? My website got taken down for being too controversial. WordPress removed it and filed a robots.txt to have it removed from the Wayback Machine. They completely deleted my directions of how to forecast an earthquake, saying it was too controversial. And maybe you'll find it, maybe you won't. I did my best to get it out to the world. You guys have a good morning, afternoon, evening, or night, Truman Show style. And I'll be back if anything else goes down, large earthquake-wise. Peace out.